بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والحمد لله رب العالمين، بارئ الخلائق أجمعين، باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين، ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين حبيب إله العالمين المصطفى أبي القاسم محمد. وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المنتجبين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه المجيد وقرآنه الحميد وقوله الحق: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قد أفلح من تزكى وذكر اسم ربه فصلى، بل تؤثرون الحياة الدنيا والآخرة خير وأبقى. صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. Over the course of our discussion over the past few nights, we will come to the conclusion tonight with the concept of tazkiyatun nafs, or self-purification. And this nafs, hopefully by now we understand that it has three components, which are really not three different, huh? It's not like we have three different nafs. They're all one, but they consist of That nafs consists of النفس الأمارة بالسوء. It consists of النفس اللوامة. And it consists of النفس المطمئنة. The one that commands one to do evil, one that blames the person whenever he disobeys his Lord and tries to bring him back on the right track, and the one that is at constant peace and tranquility. This nafs, God Almighty gave it the ability to distinguish between right and wrong, haq and batil. And that ability is the aql, the mind. So if the human being can use his aql, his mind, and control his nafsul ammarati bissu, and then control the body and its desires, then this nafs can be pulled towards the ruh until it merges with the ruh and it becomes one with the ruh, such that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he says innama amruhu idha arada shay'an an yaqula lahu kun fayakun, this mu'min, this muttaqi, this abdullah salih can also say to something kun and it becomes as well. Allah will give the mu'min, that muttaqi, that individual, that servant, this ability, this when his self, his nafs, merges with his ruh. So it has this ability. It gets that capability. So this nafs, which is connecting the human being between the ruh, that spirit of the human being, and connecting him between the desires or the body of the human being and its desires. So that's what the nafs is. And it is up to the human being with his aql to decide where he wants to take his nafs. He can ascend and ascend, ascend, as I mentioned, until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala becomes the eyes through which he sees, the ears through which he hears, and so on and so forth. Or even higher, even further ranks, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala becomes angry for their anger. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala becomes angry or happy for the pleasure of this, the pleasure of this mu'min. So not only that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be guiding this individual constantly on a regular basis as a consequence of this person's action, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will choose this man or this mu'min, this muttaqi, this individual to execute his commands on the earth, on the land. So this is an even higher rank, which is achieved by the prophets, peace be upon them, by the imams alayhim afdalu salati wa azka salam. So it is the human being, and it is his choice where he wants to go. He wants to go up there and ascend and ascend and ascend. And in doing so, then he will have the joy of dunya and the joy of akhirah. The joy of dunya is that he will live a life of peace and tranquility. no matter what occurs to that individual, what happens to this individual, he doesn't care. He's always at peace and tranquility. So in dunya, he's always happy. He's always happy. No matter what difficulties are thrown at him, you still find him not shaken, strong, and brave. One day, a lady came to Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. He had taken over their lands. Muawiyah, one of the tactics he did is that when he became the Khalifa, any individuals who are, for example, the followers of Amir al-Mu'mineen, the Shia of Amir al-Mu'mineen, so one thing is started killing the Shia of Amir al-Mu'mineen. For example, he gave a poisoned honey to Malik al-Ashtar and he killed Malik al-Ashtar. And then when the news reached Muawiyah that Malik got killed, he said, لِلَّهِ جُنُودٌ مِّنْ عَسَلٍ. Allah has army that is made of honey. So Allah's army that is made up of honey killed Malik. You know, so he killed Malik al-Ashtar. He killed Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr. May Allah bless him. He was responsible for the killing of Hijr ibn Adi. He was responsible for the killing of Amr ibn Hamaq al-Khuza'i. And so on and so forth. All these mu'mineen. So he was killing them one after the other. Another tactic he employed is that he used to go to the land that was owned by those individuals, by the Shia, by the followers of Ahlul Bayt, alayhi wasalam, and he used to seize these lands, take them all away, deprive the people of these lands for no sin and no crime other than them being the followers of Ali ibn Abi Talib, salam Allah alayhi. So one day he seized some lands. A lady came to him representing her people, her tribe. She came to him, she entered and she said, Ya ibn Abi Sufyan, you have taken our lands away and now you need to give them back to me now. I have come all the way to bring all the lands back. So right now you sign the title, you know, what we call today the title. Sign the titles now and you give them all back to me. He looked at her, you know, he's not used to somebody coming to him in his own court and addressing him like this. But he looked at her, he said, لَقَدْ أَلْضَمَكُمْ ابْنُ أَبِي طَالِبٍ الْجُرْأَةِ. Ali ibn Abi Talib has taught you to be brave like this. To be brave like this. You know, this comes because these individuals, they have submitted to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Amr ibn Hamaq al-Khuza'i, who was one of the muttaqeen, ibadullah al-saliheen, this man was one of the sincere followers of Amir al-Mu'mineen, salamullah alayhi. They kill him, they sever his head, and then they summon his wife. She comes to the court of Muawiyah. They tell her, we have something to present you with. What is it? The head of your husband, here. She looks at it, at the head of her husband, and then she starts talking to Muawiyah and telling him, well, at least he is going to Jannah. Where will you be going, ya Muawiyah? You know, this is in the court of Muawiyah. Now this lady who is afflicted with this tragedy of presenting the head of her own husband to her, yet she's so brave and strong. How did she get this bravery and this strength, this taqwa, all from the taqwa? How did she attain that taqwa? From following the path of Amir al-Mu'mineen, salamullahi alayhi. From being the student of Amir al-Mu'mineen, salamullahi alayhi. And Amir al-Mu'mineen is the student of Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So anybody who follows that path of Ahlul Bayt then ascends, goes up higher and higher in ranks. Whether it is male or female, doesn't matter. Not even male or female, even if it's a little girl. Abu al-Aswad al-Du'ali is the man who was attributed or is attributed to be the father of grammar, Arabic grammar. One day, he comes home, he finds there is honey, his daughter is eating honey. He tells his wife, where did this honey come from? She said, well, somebody knocked at our door and gave us the honey and said it's a gift from Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. He turned to his daughter and he said, do you know who sent us this honey? She was eating it. So he asked his daughter, what do you think about this honey? She said, father, I've never tasted anything beautiful like this. Nothing sweet like this. So sweet. And back then, honey was a luxury. It was not something that's easily available in the grocery store. You go buy it for a few dollars. So she said that this is so sweet, father. I've never tasted something like this. He said, but what's sweeter, this or the love of Ali ibn Abi Talib, my little girl? She was 3 years old, three. She said, my father, nothing is sweeter than the love of Ali ibn Abi Talib. He says, well, how about if I tell you that the person who sent this honey is the enemy of Ali ibn Abi Talib? She said, really? She said, yes. So she put her finger into her mouth and she puked everything that she ate. And then she said, I don't want this honey. Take it away from me. The three-year-old. And she said, أَبِ الْعَسَلِ الْمُصَفَّى يَبْنَ هِنْدٍ نَبِيعُ عَلَيْكَ أَحْسَابًا وَدِينًا كَلَّا وَكَيْفَ يَكُونُ هَذَا وَمَوْلَانَا أَمِيرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. This little three-year-old, she was reciting verses of poetry, saying, is it with sweetened honey, O son of Hind, that we sell you our religions with? You want to buy our religion with sweet honey? Never, that will never happen. For our Amir, our master, is Amir al-Mu'mineen, salamullahi alayhi. No. This is three-year-old. So these individuals, whether they're young, whether they're old, whether they're man or whether they're woman, when they follow the path of Aql, Aql tells them Ali is Haqq, Ahlul Bayt are Haqq, so they follow the Haqq. And hence Allah supports them, Allah strengthens them. And Allah makes them successful and prevail in dunya and in akhirah. Hijr ibn Adi was killed by Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. Yet go to his grave now, you have thousands if not millions of people going to do his ziyarah every day. And people are mentioning him on the pulpits since 1400 years ago until today. He's become an example. So he prevailed. His hujjah, his proof prevailed. Allah made him prevail. And what happened to Muawiyah? Allah also showed Muawiyah what happened to him. Here, his grave is nothing. It's a junkyard. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala supports those individuals who use their aql, who can recognize the haqq, the truth, and follow the truth. And then they can ascend. Or other individuals who turn off their aql. And they turn it off and they decide to become like animals, but worse than animals. They descend. And then that's when individuals don't follow Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. And hence there are people who come and they try to study themselves, they try to understand themselves, they try to study, but they don't turn to Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. And hence they get into all these confusions. And hence you have, for example, Freud, when he comes and he discusses about the human self, he says the only driving force for the human being is his desire. Everything the human being does is out of desire. The baby, for example, when it suckles milk, when it nurses milk, this is from his desire. And hence, everything the human being that he does is out of desire. You know, that's when the people don't turn to Ahlul Bayt. If we ask Freud and tell him, if this were the case, then why? How do you have people who do something out of their goodwill, the goodwill of their heart? A few years ago, I hear it on the news, some anonymous donors, they went to certain universities in the United States and they donated millions of dollars, and what they did is they got the presidents of these universities to come to the lawyers, to certain lawyers, and the president signed an agreement that they will not investigate who these donors were. They signed an agreement. So these anonymous donors donated millions of dollars, millions. I think it was 10.5 million. They divided it on several universities. And each president was asked to sign. So nobody knows, except for these lawyers or those few individuals, but otherwise no one knows who these donors are. So we ask them, what drove them to do this? Is it desire? I mean, if it's desire, they would say, okay, so-and-so donated, and hence he would have his big name, for example, at the university or in one of the departments of the university or so on and so forth. That's desire maybe sometimes. So when people don't turn to Ahlul Bayt alayhim wasalam to trying to understand who they are, what path they do, they get lost. And then even in Islam, when people don't turn to Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, then you have people going in all weird directions. So you have individuals who come up with all these different paths and different means and different ways of trying to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We say the path to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. They are the path. If we want to understand Tawheed, we go through Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Amir al-Mu'mineen teaches us Tawheed. A few years ago, I was in Mecca. I was given a book by one of those Wahhabis telling me that, you know, here, read this about Tawheed, written by one of the leaders. We won't mention his name now. I looked at the book. I said, I don't need him to tell me about Tawheed. I have Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib telling me about Tawheed. You know, I don't need this guy to tell me about it. When he himself doesn't understand Tawheed. He wants to explain it to me. So take it back. If we want to understand Tawheed, I told him, go turn to the first sermon of Nahj al-Balagha. That will tell you about Tawheed. Where Amir al-Mu'mineen describes the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, telling us that you cannot describe Allah in forms, in body form. Allah is not a physical shape to be limited in space or time, wal-iyadu billah. No. That's where we understand Tawheed. And hence, when we understand Tawheed, then we understand Nubuwwah. We understand Ma'ad. We understand Adala. We understand Imama. Because everything then falls into place. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just. You know, this is very something that's very logical. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator. Allah is the one who made this whole universe. Okay, now that I know Allah has created everything, I know this now. Okay, it makes sense. This universe has to have a creator. It could not all come by coincidence. All this perfection could not come by coincidence. There had to be somebody who designed it. So, okay, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, now that I recognize Allah, some people stop right there and they say, well, let me worship Allah the way I want to worship Him. That's nonsense. If you love Allah, you approve that Allah exists, Allah is the creator, then I need to understand, how does Allah want me to worship Him? How does He like me to worship Him? Sometimes you like somebody, you want to give him a present. You tell him, I don't really know, what do you like? Please tell me, I want to buy you a present. What do you like? What shall I get you? You know? So you want to know what the person likes, so you give him a present that he is happy with. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when a person uses a little bit of his aql, he will recognize, come to understand that Allah exists. Allah exists. And hence, when Allah exists, then how does He want me to worship Him? Not the way I like, the way He likes. That's the problem Allah had with Iblis. Iblis, they said, Allah, let me worship you the way I want. He said, no, Iblis, I want you to worship me the way I want, not the way you want. He said, Ya Allah, I will do sujood to you for thousands of years, like I have done in the past. Thousands of years I'll do sujood to you, Ya Allah, but not to Adam. He said, no, I want you to do sujood. Yes, you are doing sujood to me, but the qibla is Adam. Your qibla is Adam. So you have to do sujood towards Adam. He's your qibla. He said, no, Ya Allah, then that was a problem. He failed. So now that I know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator, He is the one who is the master of the universe, how does He want me to worship Him? And hence, that makes common sense that He has to send prophets. There has to be prophets, individuals who guide me as to how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want me to worship Him. Makes perfect sense. Now we understand. Okay, so now that there is a prophet, now let us go through not just one prophet or two prophets. I have to go through the whole chains of the prophets. All those who were sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And hence that takes me to the Khatam al-Anbiya'i Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. We come to understand that, you know, the Prophet exists. Okay, well, I worship Allah. I do a good things in Allah and obeying Allah in this dunya. Okay, and then once I die, that's it. It's finished. Khalas. Then what's the point of doing ibadah and worshiping Allah? You know, this nonsense. So Allah wants me to worship Him. He wants me to pray 5 times a day. He wants me to refrain from looking at the haram things. He doesn't want me to go, for example, and have parties with those people who have parties in a haram way. He doesn't like this. So I have to deprive myself of all these pleasures of dunya, you know, and worship Allah and obey Allah. And then at the end, once I die, khalas, then this person who enjoyed the parties, then he is the smart one, not me. You know, I'm not smart of doing so. So then common sense tells me, no, there has to be a consequence for my actions. And hence, there has to be hisab after this life. There has to be another life. There has to be a consequence. And hence, there is ma'ad. That takes me to ma'ad. Makes me understand. There is a day of judgment. Okay, now the Prophet is the master. The minute he leaves this dunya, khalas, that's it. We can come and we can elect and vote. Well, if we accept Allah, if we accept the Prophet, if we accept the day of judgment, we come to understand that the Prophet is telling us and the Quran is telling us that always Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who appoints. He is the one who appoints the divine leaders, the spiritual leaders, the prophets. It has never been a case in the Quran, if we go across the whole Quran, that people got together and said, we vote for so-and-so to become the prophet. He's a good man. He's rich, mashallah, wealthy. So he becomes the prophet. We don't have such a case. Allah appoints them. Allah chooses them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses the khulafa. He chooses the khalifa, the successors. إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَ. I am making representatives on this earth. I'm choosing them. Allah tells Dawood, Ya Dawood, I am making you a khalifa. I'm choosing you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always choosing. Allah chooses the imam. Allah tells Ibrahim, إِنِّي جَاعِلُكَ لِلنَّاسِ إِمَامًا. I am making you an imam. We never have a case where people got together and they vote. They say, well, we'll choose him as our imam. He's pretty good. Even when Bani Israel wanted to have a king to fight Talut with, to fight Jalut with, well, sorry, to fight Jalut against Jalut. They wanted a king. They had a prophet. They went to their prophet. They told the prophet, this is in Surah Al-Baqarah, pray to Allah to send us a king. Send us a king. So this king will lead us to victory against Jalut. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for them Talut. He said, Talut will be your king. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses. He chooses. Then it makes sense. So the prophet then dies and that's it. I can't have a group of people coming together and they choose who will be the next imam, who will be the next khalifa. And that makes perfect sense. Then the prophet has to continue, his line has to continue. And then he explains him the imamah. And that takes me right to the imamah. So here you see everything is falling right into steps. Usul al-Din, just by through a little bit of thinking and through a little bit of understanding about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a little bit of understanding about Ahlul Bayt, the aql, if the aql is working, khalas. And then we come to the adala, the justice, divine justice. Allah has to be just. Allah has to be just. In every action of His, Allah has to have justice. We have to believe in this. And hence, when some people start questioning, why do some babies die, for example? Why some parts in the world there are individuals who are so poor, but then other parts of the world there are people who are so rich? You know, these doubts are entering into the minds of people. Well, that tells us that Allah is adil. Allah has justice. And hence, whenever there is a poor person who's dying, it's because that rich individual has deprived him. So why do we hold Allah responsible for this? Allah gave us the aql and He said, use it. You rich people have to support the poor people. If the rich supports the poor, then people would not be dying. A few years ago, there was a case in one of the countries, one of the big countries, where you saw in the milk was contaminated. And many children started having kidney stones. So now we say, Ya Allah, you're responsible for this. Some individuals, they went after the milk and they did not inspect it very well because of the corruption or whatever it was. And the milk got contaminated and the children ate that powder. And then, so this is all up to the human being, his corruption, his greed. Allah is testing us. So this tells us Allah is just. Allah has adala. Otherwise, on the day of judgment, Allah cannot hold people responsible for their actions. If it is not us with our free will, we have a free will. We can choose what is haqq, what is batil, what is right, what is wrong. We can choose this. Otherwise, on the day of judgment, we can stand there and we can contest. Ya Allah, you did not give me the choice. You did not give me that. Why are you punishing me now? So all this falls into right. Usul al-Din will fall right into place if the person has a little bit of aqil and can really understand this. And so my brothers and my sisters, in order for us to understand our religion, to really purify ourselves, we turn to Ahlul Bayt, alayhim as-salam. We have to turn to Ahlul Bayt. That is the ultimate way for us to purify our souls. The ultimate way for us to cleanse our nafs by following their path, by understanding their path. This is the path of haq. And hence, we come to the hadith that says, "Man arafa nafsah, faqad arafa rabbah." Amir al-Mu'mineen, salamullah alayhi, says, whomever recognizes himself, he has recognized his Lord. This hadith has two interpretations, or at least I have come across two interpretations. Maybe there are more. One interpretation is that this nafs, if we can recognize how destitute it is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how much in need it is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullah alayhi says, Miskin ibn Adam. This is the son of Adam is really, you know, we feel sorry for him. Why? Because a small mosquito can come and bite him and it can change his whole state. A little mosquito bites a person and he starts aching for some time. From the bite of a mosquito, a little bug. And maybe that mosquito can even kill him. If it carries a disease with it, then that little mosquito kills this man. He says, and if he walks a little bit and then he trips, he starts bleeding. He says, what is this man? So then, why is he so full of himself? Why doesn't he remember Allah when he is so weak? One day one of the kings was sitting down on his throne, you know, feeling all arrogant and proud. All of a sudden a fly comes, a fly, and he starts, you know, moving it away. Again, the fly comes, you know, and irritates him. And he starts shaking it away until finally he was going so much like this that he fell off. He fell off. So he became upset. He said, why did Allah create the fly? لِمَا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ الذُّبَابُ Why did he create the fly? The person was sitting next to him. He said, so that Allah would humiliate tyrants like you. You know, to humiliate tyrants like you. You're sitting on your throne thinking that you are the king. خلاص, you're the king of the world. You're the king of the world. All of a sudden, one little fly distracts your whole, you know, state, changes your whole state, and throws you off your throne. A fly throws you off your throne. So wake up a little bit, O son of Adam. Wake up. This is whom you really are. Nothing. You were nothing, and you'll become nothing. The only thing that will remain is amal al-salih. Amal al-salih. That is the thing that will remain. So if the person can recognize that, you know what, I'm nothing without the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is Razzaq. Allah is the Azeem. I'm not Azeem. I'm not great. He is the great one. Allah is the Kareem. He is the generous. I'm not generous. You know, whatever generosity I have, it is from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me. If a person recognizes this, perfect. He knows. Then he knows his Lord. Then he can identify that he is nothing and Allah is everything. It is said one day a man came to Imam Sadiq salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi in Mina. That was not a very good salawat. Recite the louder salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Since we made it two, let's make it three with a loud salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, one day was in Mina, a man came to him, a beggar, asking for some help in Mina. So Imam al-Sadiq salamullah alayhi took a vine of grape and he gave it to him, one vine of grape. He said, Ya ibn Rasulullah, but I want money. I don't want this grape, money. He said, well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you. And he left. A little while later, another poor person, another beggar came by. He said, do you have anything to help me with? Imam Sadiq said he took a little bit, few grapes, and he gave it to him. When he gave it to him, this man said, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ya Allah, this is from your rizq. This is your rizq to me. So then Imam Sadiq told him, hold on. So he took a handful of grapes, one handful, and he said, take this. He took it. He said, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ya Allah, thank you. This is from you, Ya Allah. So then Imam Sadiq said, wait. He turned to his servant. He said, how much money do you have? How much money do you have on you? He said, I have 20 dirhams. He said, give me the 20 dirhams. He gave him the 20 dirhams. He said, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ya Allah, this is from you. Alhamdulillah. And then Imam Sadiq said, well, hold on. He took off his shirt. He said, here, have my shirt as well. He took the shirt and he said, Ilahi laka alhamd. Oh Allah, thank you. And then he turned to Imam Sadiq and he said, may Allah bless you and increase in your sustenance. May Allah increase you of his wealth. And then he left. The person narrating the hadith says, if this man continued to say Alhamdulillah and did not thank Imam al-Sadiq, he would have continued giving him. Because why? He recognized that the ultimate giver is Allah. So the first case, the first man, Imam al-Sadiq gave him a whole vine of grapes. He said, no, I don't want this. Give me money. A person who does not have gratitude, ya akhi. And you're begging. So it's fine. Pray to Allah. Thank Allah for everything. Imam al-Sadiq has given you this vine. Say, Alhamdulillah. The other man, Imam al-Sadiq gave him few grapes. Yet he said, Ya Allah, Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. You know, we are all in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we recognize Allah and we recognize how much we need Allah, that's when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then also blesses us and reminds us that you are always in need of Allah. That is when Allah says, فَذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ Remember me and I will remember you. or about other people. When Allah says they forgot about Allah, so we made them forget about themselves as well. Or they forgot about Allah, so Allah forgot about them as well. Allah doesn't forget about anybody. Allah doesn't forget about anyone. But He makes these individuals forget that they are in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because they forgot about Allah. They don't care about Allah, wal-iyadu billah. So Allah makes them also forget that they need Allah. And hence they think that they are the ones. Khalas, they do everything on their own. Whereas on the contrary, when a mu'min remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, constantly saying, Ya Allah, alhamdulillah. Everything you've given me, alhamdulillah. Oh Allah, all these difficulties that I'm experiencing in my life, yet again, alhamdulillah, I'm still in need of you, Ya Allah. When I'm doing well, business is running well, I say, alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Ya Allah, I'm still in need of you. And I help the poor, and I give to those who are in need, help the orphans, establish the schools, build the hospitals, and so on and so forth. When I don't have, again, I say, alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. So when a person constantly does dhikr of Allah, Allah says, we will remember him as well. Allah will do his dhikr as well. He will remind him. God forbid, if at time this person who constantly remembers Allah comes a point when he forgets a little bit, shaitan tries to whisper to him or make him forget, Allah will remind him. Allah will wake him up. Allah will move him. Allah will shake him. In any way possible. One day there was a man by the name of Ibn Adham, Ibrahim Ibn Adham. This man was a king. One day he heard one of those nusak, you know, a person who's a zahid, his abid. He tells him, Yabna Adham. He told him, Yabna Adham, do you think this mulk is yours? This kingdom is yours? It is not yours. It doesn't belong to you. The true mulk is to Allah. This one word was enough to shake him, to move him. One word. Khalas. It shook him. It moved him. And he gave up the kingdom. He gave up the becoming a king. And he became a zahid. He went and bought a little farm. And he started farming his farm and eating from it every day and feeding other people. About 20 people used to come around him. And they sat to eat with him. So that's when an individual remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah tried to wake him up. Even if for a little bit he forgets about Allah, Allah will wake him up. So that is one definition of the hadith that man arafa nafsah, arafa rabbah. Whomever understands himself and recognizes how poor and how destitute he is, then he constantly grows in his belief and respect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and dhikr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is one. The second definition that I've come across is that since Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot be understood, Allah cannot be comprehended, Allah cannot be understood. And hence the nafs, to really understand our nafs is also impossible. It is impossible to really have a clear understanding. The other day I mentioned Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullah alayhi describes, for example, four types of nafs within the nafs of the human being. Or not the human being, different things. The plants have a nafs, but their nafs is different from the nafs of the human being. The nafs of the human being is different from the nafs of the animals. The animal doesn't have aql, for example. And hence, Amir al-Mu'mineen is describing these different kinds of nafs and how complicated the nafs becomes. And this is, of course, Amir al-Mu'mineen is talking to a mind of a person, yet he was one of the great sahaba. But nonetheless, he doesn't have the mind of Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullah alayhi. So Amir al-Mu'mineen still has to simplify things. Otherwise, if he were to talk about the language that we understand today, this person would get lost. So it is difficult to understand one nafs. However, all that our aql can understand and comprehend is what the ayah in the Quran that we just recited. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ تَزَكَّى وَذَكَرَ اسْمَ رَبِّهِ فَصَلَّى. Indeed, successful is the one who does tazkiyah. Tazkiyah of his nafs. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. That's something we understand. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, O people, try to purify your nafs. Try to cleanse your nafs. How you do so? By following the path of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. When a person cleanses his nafs, then that cleanse improves his akhlaq. So the whole essence of tazkiyatun nafs is really an ethical essence. It comes from the ethical point of view, from the akhlaqi point of view. And that's why ulama al-akhlaq, the scholars of akhlaq, for example, Sheikh Mahdi al-Naraqi in his book, Jami'u al-Sa'adat, which is a book of akhlaq, he says when a person can cleanse his nafs, can cleanse his nafs to the state, does tazkiyah, where he can ascend, then he will be ready to accept the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that will help carry him further and further, higher and higher. If the person, for example, is, let's say, can only lift 10 kilograms, unless he exercises, for example, and strengthens himself, he won't be able to lift 20 kilograms or 30 kilograms. He can't, khalas. That's his limit. So a person has to exercise. He has to work hard until he becomes stronger, he can lift 20. Then he can lift 30. And then he can lift like those, mashallah, big guys, 1,000 kilograms. All through exercise. Through exercise. Similarly, the nafs of the human being, some people are only capable of lifting 10 kilograms, you know, metaphorically speaking. Can only handle a little bit. Others can lift 100. Some people can lift 1,000. So how did they all do all this? Through their tazkiyatun nafs. And hence, the purification of the nafs leads to better akhlaq. Better akhlaq. To have better akhlaq, that is a process of tazkiyatun nafs. And what we have been discussing over the past few nights, brothers and sisters, we've been saying that respecting Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam will cleanse ourselves. We'll do tazkiyatun nafs, respecting them. Attending the majalis of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein also does tazkiyah of the nafs. Remembering Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam does tazkiyah of the nafs. If we find and we follow the path of Ahlul Bayt, we come across, for example, Malik, who a person hits him with a date, he does istighfar for him. He goes to the masjid and he prays for him. And on the contrary, you have Ziyad ibn Abi, Ziyad, the father of Ubayd, or the so-called father, you know, we don't know. Nonetheless, Ziyad ibn Abi, one day a man hits him with a pebble as he was entering Masjid al-Kufa, or inside Masjid al-Kufa, a person hits him with a pebble. Now look at the school of Ahlul Bayt and what it teaches us. The school of Ahlul Bayt, Malik goes into Masjid al-Kufa and prays for the person who hit him and does istighfar for him. This man, Ziyad, says, close all the gates. Close all the gates. They close all the gates of the masjid. He says, cut off the hands of everyone in the masjid. Everybody. One person committed a crime, everybody has to pay for it. You know, this is what happens when people don't follow the school of Ahlul Bayt. So when people follow that school of Ahlul Bayt, you find their akhlaq, subhanAllah, they ascend. They ascend in their akhlaq to be of such character that even the person who hits them, they still help him or they pray for him. So this comes then from tazkiyatun nafs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ تَزَكَّى وَذَكَرَ اسْمَ رَبِّهِ فَصَلَّى. And he remembers the name of his Lord, so he prays for him. He remembers Allah. This individual, successful is he who de-attaches himself from the materialistic dunya, from the materialistic world. He doesn't attach himself to the materialistic world. That doesn't mean he doesn't wear the good clothes. He doesn't live in a good house. But he is not attached to it. One day, a man by the name of Sufyan al-Thawri. Sufyan al-Thawri was one of the students of Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. But he was on the same, let's say, path of Imam Abu Hanifa. So he was not really on the path of Ahlul Bayt. Abu Hanifa Nu'man, Imam Abu Hanifa, was also a student of Imam al-Sadiq, but he had his own way. Sufyan al-Thawri, similarly, he had his own way as well. Nonetheless, one day Sufyan al-Thawri enters to visit Imam al-Sadiq. He looks at Imam al-Sadiq and he was wearing some nice, decent clothes, you know, some fancy stuff. He looks at him, he says, did your grandfather Rasulullah wear this kind of clothes? So why are you wearing such clothes? Subhanallah, sometimes, you know, we want to teach our imams. You know, this guy is teaching the imam, alayhi salam. Yani, what do you know? What's your level of understanding? And that's the disaster. We're laughing, but sometimes we go to the maraja' as well. Some people and say, why does this marja' say this? Why did that marja', for example, declare Eid the next day? Why didn't he declare Ramadan the day? Yani, alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen. We all become maraja' all of a sudden. Everybody becomes a faqih and a alim. So they start criticizing and critiquing the ulama and the fuqaha. Yani, yes, become a faqih, become a alim, and then yes, you have all the right to go ahead and criticize and critique. But until you've reached that level of ijtihad, then we become like Sufyan al-Thawri as well. Sufyan, we come and we start teaching the imam, alayhi salam. We start complaining against the imam, alayhi salam. So, he tells him, why you're wearing this? You know, the interesting thing is this Sufyan, he knows who Imam al-Sadiq is. He knows who Imam al-Sadiq is. But subhanAllah, you know, he learned a couple of words, you know, a couple of sentences, he's read a couple of books, and all of a sudden now he thinks that he is khalas. That's it. He's become the marji' al-a'la. That's it. You know, it is said one day a man took a cat. He has never seen a cat before. Some parts in Arabia, sometimes they don't see cats. So one day he saw a cat, he saw there's something really nice, it has fur, whatever. So he took it. When he took it, somebody came by and said, oh, in Arabic, a cat has many names. The cat, in Arabic language, it has several names. So one guy came by and looked at it and said, oh, ma hadha al-hir? What is this hir? Another guy came, he said, oh, ma hadhihi al-qitta? What is this qitta, for example? Another guy came and said, ma hadha al-sannur? What is this sannur? So this guy said, mashallah, this thing seems to be something that's precious here, you know. All these names and whatever. So he said, you know, if I sell it in the market, I might get a good price for it. So he came and he started selling it in the market. Nobody even looked at it. So the whole day he's sitting in the market trying to sell this cat. One day in the afternoon, when this guy's sitting the whole day, one guy came by, he said, what are you doing? He said, I'm selling this thing. One person said its name is Hir. One person said its name is Qit. One person said its name is this. This guy has so many names, you know, and look at the fur. I thought this thing is something expensive. He said, people are kicking this thing out of their homes. You know, you want to give it into their homes? People don't even take this. You know, only in this part of the world, you know, where in the West, where people take it and give it to the food and whatever. But there, nobody cares about it. Then he looked at the cat. قال ما قبحك الله ما أكثر اسمك وما أقل نفعك. He said, you have so many names. He said, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala curse you. To the cat, he told. You have so many names, but you have no value. And then he threw it away. And that's unfortunately how some people are. Some people, they read one book, they read two books, and all of a sudden they become fuqaha, ulama. They start giving fatwas, they start doing tafsir of the Holy Quran, the way they understand. Yani, we need to understand a little bit, have a bit of understanding. So this man, Sufyan al-Thawri, is coming to Imam al-Sadiq, alayhi salam, telling him that, why you're wearing these decent, nice clothes? You look, these expensive clothes. Did your grandfather Rasulullah wear something like this? He said, first of all, at the time of my grandfather Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Muslims were poor. And hence, what the Prophet used to wear is what the average Muslim at the time used to wear. And hence, that he used to wear simple clothes. Today, alhamdulillah, Muslims are doing very well. MashaAllah, they've gone into business, and now Islam has expanded, and so on, all the way to, for example, the borders of China. So things have gone really well. Muslims now, mashallah, are doing well. So then, why should I wear, you know, those simple clothes of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you know? Second thing, Rasulullah was the Khalifa. Not only was he the Prophet, he was also the Khalifa, he was the Imam. He was the leader, the worldly leader. So as the worldly leader, then he had also to share the lifestyle of the simplest man in his state. And hence he would wear these simple clothes, for example, so that he can share the life of the simplest man in the state. I am not the Khalifa. يعني, the Khalifa is somebody else. Yes, he is the spiritual the Khalifa. He is Khalifa al-Haq. But the worldly, at least, Khalifa is not in his hands. It's in somebody else's hands. The third thing is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes when he blesses somebody. When he blesses somebody, Allah likes to see this blessing, this ni'mah upon him. He likes this. وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. So you find some people, ya akhi Allah, they're millionaires, but they say business is terrible. Every time you see them, business is bad. You come donate, ya akhi, for this gas tank. No gas tank, ya akhi. My gas tank is out of fuel. You want me to? And every time complaining, these individuals, Allah then will punish them. Allah one day will take their. Allah likes to see when he gives ni'mah to somebody, he likes to see that this person shows it, displays it, show it off. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he gives us ni'mah, he wants to see the ni'mah. Otherwise, he will deprive the person of the ni'mah. So I gave you and you're not using it. Then why should I give you? So the ni'mah will be deprived. And then he told him also, look at me. On the outside, I'm wearing something that's fancy and expensive. You are wearing something that's cheap and whatever on the outside. But let's come. He removed the clothes. Imam had a rough cloth, clothes underneath, rough, something that is not smooth against his skin. He says, this reminds me that, you know what, I should not be enjoying this cotton and this expensive clothes. You know, this reminds me that, you know what, this something is only for dunya. So these people, we should not be attracted to these beautiful, comforting clothes. At the end, one day we will leave them and we'll go to akhirah. So this reminds me of this. You, on the contrary, come here. Remove what's underneath your sleeve. He removed under his sleeve. There was a nice, comforting cotton layer. He said, what you have done is you kept the comfortable clothes on your skin and the cheap ones, the modest ones, to the people. So you want to show people that, you know what, I'm a modest person, I'm humble, huh? That's what you want people to see. But on the inside, you're nice and comfortable. He said, so we can live a nice life. We can live, you know, a life as long as it's not in the path of the ma'siyah of Allah, wal-iyadu billah. But as long as it is not the life of extravagance, wal-iyadu billah. It's not the life of israf. Not the life of israf. Somewhere in the middle. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us, we pay our khums, we pay our zakat, we pay our charities, we pay the sadaqat, we pay the huquq. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He gives us whatever is enough to sustain us and make us live a decent life. Some people buy mansions. They have mansions. But you really need that mansion. Because then you get attached to the mansion. That's the problem. People are attached. One day they came to Abu Dhar al-Ghafari. They said, Ya Abu Dhar al-Ghafari, Ya Abu Dhar, why do we hate death? He said, because you built your homes in dunya and you ruined your homes in the akhirah. So obviously you don't like to go from a built home into a ruined home. That's why you hate death. But if you build your akhirah, then you would love to go towards your akhirah. But that's the problem. That's our problem. And that's when a person does not do tazkiyatun nafs, when he does not reach that state of understanding. And that's why we have to follow the path of Ahlul Bayt, brothers and sisters. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ تَزَكَّى وَذَكَرَ اسْمَ رَبِّهِ فَصَلَّى. Then Allah says the problem. You have a problem, human beings. بَلْ تُؤْثِرُونَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا. You prefer the dunya. You live, you prefer the dunya. بَلْ تُؤْثِرُونَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا. However, which is the real life? Which is the eternal life? وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. The akhirah is the one that's a real life. The akhirah is where you're going to stay for the rest of your whole life. That's it. God forbid, either in Jahannam wal-iyadu billah or in Jannah. So then why waste the few days in dunya and then you sell your whole akhirah for them? Amir al-Mu'mineen, when he describes the muttaqeen in his sermon, he says, صَبَرُوا أَيَّامًا قَلِيلَةً أَتْبَعَتْهُمْ رَاحَةً طَوِيلَةً تِجَارَةٌ مُرْبِحَةً. He says, they were patient for a few days, the days of dunya. Then it was followed by eternal comfort. Eternal comfort. He said, that indeed is the good business. That is the good business. 50 years, 60 years, you watch yourself in dunya. 50 years, 60 years, I watch my tongue. I make sure I don't do ghiba wal-iyadu billah. 50 years, I try to watch myself not to look at the haram wal-iyadu billah. Not to listen to the music and all the haram. When people are doing ghiba in a majlis, I should not be standing there. Get out, leave. Tell them, you know what, sorry. I don't like to have this ghiba in here. If you're not going to stop, I'm going to leave. Sayyid Bahr al-Ulum, the marji', when he was a little boy, he was 7 or 8 years old, one day they saw him running out of a majlis crying. He said, they were doing ghiba in that majlis and I was afraid that Allah will curse us. At the age of 7 or 8. And then the minute we hear something, we don't immediately jump to conclusions. Somebody said one word, and nowadays it's going on as well. One person said one word, and people who have no understanding, they don't even have half a fraction of what the knowledge he has. They start saying, oh, why did he say this? One alim says one word. Oh, why did this alim say this? Why did he say that? And all the commoner people, ya akhi, have you reached the state of ilm? Leave it to the ulama. Let them to discuss it. But that's our problem. We hear one word, we start interpreting any way we want to interpret them. And then we start sending emails immediately, 1,000 people. This person, don't follow him anymore. Khalas. Or this person, he's creating a lot of trouble. So, yani, why create all these problems? What if you misunderstood what he said? Is there such a possibility or there isn't such a possibility? Yani, unless you become Luqman al-Hakim or Al-Khidr alayhi salam. But otherwise, I don't know if there is a chance that you misunderstood. Is there a chance, even if it's 10%? Then why take a risk? Why take up the problem? And then calling people and phoning people and started. And we need to understand ourselves a little bit, have this patience a little bit. 50 years, 60 years, 100 years in this dunya, we just live a low profile. I have my life and khalas. People, I don't know what, you know. I have my own problems. Let me understand, you know, Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullah says, he says, if a person doesn't even understand himself, why is he worried about other people? You know, worry about yourself. Go after yourself. He says, whomever is busy with his own faults, he will be busy from the people's faults. He won't be looking at them. But whenever somebody doesn't look at his own faults, he's not busy with his faults, then he becomes busy with what? With the people and what they have done. So that is all our problem in dunya. 50 years, 60 years, ya akhi, wait, have patience. Our ladies don't wear the hijab. They don't want to. They don't want to. Ya akhi, you tell her 50 years, 60 years, wear it. And then khalas, you have the eternal joy in the akhirah. You'll have the eternal joy. You can do whatever you want in Jannah. What? No. تُؤْثِرُونَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا. You like dunya. You want to show yourself. I want to do ghibah. I want to listen to the music. I want to see the haram. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. When a person realizes that this is life is very short, nothing is worth it, then my akhlaq becomes better. My manners become better. Then I can ascend in the path of spirituality. And all this we can learn from Ahlul Bayt, alayhim as-salam, brothers and sisters. Everything comes from Ahlul Bayt. So the more we can love them, the more we can follow them, the more we can obey them, the more we can be on the Siratul Mustaqim, the more we can ascend in the path of spirituality. Some people, you find them attending, for example, one or two nights out of these few nights of Muharram, they attend. Some people don't even attend at all. Some people attend a few nights. Some people, they attend the whole nights. Some people, they participate only in the majlis and then they leave. Some people, no, participate even in the aza and the latub, in the matam. And they stay until the very end. So it all degrees of how much people really love Ahlul Bayt. And I'm not talking about those, for example, who have children or whatever. No, these are, we excuse them. But those individuals who, no, they have the time. They don't. But this is, that's it. They come up with excuses. Oh, I'm busy. I have this. We all can come up with excuses. I have children. I have parents. I have work to do. I have whatever to do to look after. We always have excuses. Shaitan always gives you 100 excuses, 1,000 excuses not to attend the majlis. He gives you 1,000 excuses not to pay, not to give donation, not to give sadaqat. But we have to realize what is haqq and what is batil. And Ahlul Bayt are haqq. Their love is haqq. Allah tells us in the Quran, mawaddah. The Prophet is telling, I want you to love my family. Follow my family. Sacrifice for the sake of my family. Do whatever you want, as long as it's for Ahlul Bayt. And you do it with understanding, you get reward for it. That's why our ulama, they say for Hussein alayhi salam, some of the ulama, they say there is no limit in the love of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. There is no limit for the love of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. So the more we can go into the path of Ahlul Bayt, the more we can ascend. We can go higher. Allah. And the blessings will come upon us in dunya and in the akhirah. That's why, brothers and sisters, if you can, hold majalis of Ahlul Bayt in your homes. Hold them in your homes. If you can hold them, for example, on a monthly basis, hold it on a monthly basis. If you can't on a monthly basis, on an annual basis, hold the majalis. I have not yet seen or heard any mu'min or mu'mina who held majalis in their house and then they regret it afterwards. They said, no, I wish I did not hold these majalis at my place. We haven't seen anyone like this. In fact, anybody who started holding majalis at their place, they continue with it. Because they saw what the benefits, the barakah that comes into their house. And you don't have to make it a huge majlis. You can do whatever limit, you know, whatever. You can invite 2 people, 5 people, yourself. And you don't have to give lots of food and all that stuff. Water is enough. The majlis, the dhikr of Ahlul Bayt is what brings the barakah into the house. Connecting ourselves with Imam Hussein alayhi salam on a daily basis, reading the ziyarah of Abi Abdullah Hussein, ziyarat Ashura. Reading the ziyarah, for example, ziyarat Ashura on a daily basis. It has a lot of merit. Ziyat Ashura. Try to read it. It takes about 5-10 minutes. Read Ziyat Ashura on a daily basis. This connects you with Imam Hussein on a daily basis. Pray 2 rak'at namaz and gift it to Ahlul Bayt alayhim wassalam on a daily basis. This connects you with Ahlul Bayt on a daily basis. Having majalis is another way. Attending the majalis is another way. So we have to do all these things, brothers and sisters, and that will ascend us, make us go up, up, and higher in the path of Ahlul Bayt alayhim wassalam. And then we can be ready to realize the beautiful joy of following Ahlul Bayt. Then we can understand, you know what, my life has changed, alhamdulillah, since I have followed the path of Ahlul Bayt, since now I'm loving them more and more. I'm watching my temper, I'm watching my anger, I'm watching my tongue, I'm watching my eyes, I'm watching my ear. I'm happy, alhamdulillah. I know I'm happy. I'm at peace with myself. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless the individual with this happiness, which is priceless, priceless. One person, he's a wealthy businessman. He was talking to one of the ulama. He says, Sayyid, in breakfast, I never enjoy my breakfast, never. He said, why? Why not? Why don't you enjoy your breakfast? He said, alhamdulillah, I'm a very wealthy businessman and I invest in stocks. In the morning, as I'm having my breakfast, I look at, for example, the business news. And you know the ticker tape that goes on the bottom, which this stock has gone up, this stock has gone down. This stock was raised and this was lowered. He says, every time I have one bite of food and I see the stock has gone collapsed. So here I lost $10,000. And there goes the joy of my food. Then I drink another sip of coffee, for example, and that stock has also collapsed. And there goes another, for example, $10,000. And the whole breakfast is like this. My whole breakfast every day is like this. He said, Ya akhi, why do you need this much money? Do you really need all this wealth? Do you really need all this headache and stress for your life? Have a simple breakfast. Enjoy your dunya. Enjoy your akhirah. Enjoy your life. So this is the problem of the human being. He doesn't understand this. And that's why, unfortunately, we choose to disobey Allah. Wal-iyadu billah. Otherwise, if we understand that the joys and happiness of purifying ourselves and the merits of it, we would never give it up. How come Hijr ibn Adi gave up his life in the path of Ahlul Bayt? How come the companions of Imam Hussein gave up their lives in the path of Ahlul Bayt? Burair, as I mentioned a few nights ago, he was joking on the day of Ashura with Abdul Rahman, one of the companions. He told him, is this the time of joking? He said, yes, indeed. He said, God knows and my family knows that I never speak of vanity, but there's only 1 hour and a fighting between us and these enemies that will then take us to Jannah. In 1 hour, we'll be in Jannah. So isn't this a time to celebrate? Isn't this a time of happiness? This is the true joy. How come? How come the companions of Ahlul Bayt, alayhim wassalam, they had this love? Because they understood the love of Ahlul Bayt. And hence, they were willing to sacrifice their lives for the love of Ahlul Bayt. Because that was priceless. Priceless. So that is something we need to come up with these 10 nights or 13 nights, brothers and sisters. How much do we love Ahlul Bayt? How much am I willing to sacrifice for them? How much am I willing to purify myself for them? If I look at how much they suffered, how much they went through, then any of my sufferings is nothing compared to theirs. Nothing. And hence, any of my difficulties, I say, Ya Allah, just like you gave the patience to Ahlul Bayt, give me the patience as well to face my difficulties. Ya Allah, bless me in dunya and in the akhirah to be among their lover, to be among their shi'a. For 3 days, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, his body without a head lying on the plains of Karbala, him and the companions, all 3 days. Bila ghuslin wala kafan. There is no ghusl and no kafan. For 3 days, the grandson of Rasulullah, Sayyid Shababi Ahlil Jannah, on the plains of Karbala, him and his companions, and his family members, bodies without heads, lying there for 3 days. On the 13th day of Muharram, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through his command and through his will, Imam al-Sajjad, salamullah alayhi, manages by the will of Allah to leave the camp and attend, to leave the prison without nobody noticing. And he comes. As he arrives into Karbala, he says a tribe by the name of the tribe of Bani Sa'ad or Bani Asad. Bani Asad. Bani Asad were standing there looking at the bodies. He approaches them. They see him coming from a distance. They did not recognize him at first. They thought he was one of the spies for Yazid or Ubaydullah ibn Sa'd. So they did not say anything. He approached them. He said, what are you doing here? They told him, we came to look at the bodies. He said, no, tell me the truth. Why did you come here? They told him, if we tell you, would you give us your word that you will never tell anyone? You would not tell us to Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad. You give us the peace, aman? He said, yes, tell me. They said, we came here to bury the bodies of those martyrs. We came here to bury the body of Abi Abdullah al-Husayn. He said, then what is stopping you? Why are you stopped? Why don't you bury them? They said, oh man, the bodies are bodies without heads. We don't know whose body belongs to whom. If we bury them, somebody will come and ask us, people, where is the grave, for example, of Abi Abdullah al-Husayn? Where is the grave of so-and-so? Where is the grave of so? We don't know. How can we say? That's why we were stopped here. He said, then come and help me. Come and give me the aid. Help me. He then dug a grave in which he put all the companions, alayhim as-salam, and he said, come and help me bury the companions. Then they came and they helped him burying the companions. So they put all the companions in one area. And today, if you go to Karbala, you see all the shuhada there in that one area where Imam as-Sajjad, salamullahi alayhi, prayed on them, except Hur. Hur was the only exception because his family, Bani Riyahi, they came and they picked him up on the 11th day of Muharram. So that's why Hur is buried on a distance. They prayed on him and they buried him. The rest of the shuhada were all prayed on by Imam al-Sajjad, salamullahi alayhi. So they all were buried into that grave. Then Imam alayhi salam dug another grave. And then he came to the body of his father, Abi Abdullah al-Husayn. He hugged the body of his father. Qala Aba, inna huzni lasarmad. وَإِنَّ لَيْلِي لَمُسَهَّيَدْ. O Father Abi Abdullah, I will grieve for you for eternity until I am united with you in Jannah. And my nights are sleepless after you, O my father. That's when the tribe of Bani Asad recognized this is Ali ibn al-Husayn Zayn al-Abidin alayhi salam. Then he carried the body of his father. He put it into the grave. Then he looked around and he brought the baby, Ali al-Asghar. He remembered the will of his father to him when he told him, Bunay Ali wasid radi'i ala sadri. Oh, my son Ali, put my baby on my chest when you bury me. Make him bury him with me. So he buried him with him, and then Bani Asad, they saw him looking for something. They told him, Ya Ibn Rasulillah, what are you looking for? He said, I'm looking for the finger of my father, Abi Abdullah al-Husayn. When the enemy wanted to take the ring off the finger of my father, he couldn't. So he took off his dagger and he cut off the finger of my father, Abi Abdullah. And hence I want to bury even the finger of my father. So he buried the whole body together. And then he looked and he buried the rest of the mu'mineen and the rest of the family members. Then he turned, he said, is there anybody left? They said, yes, there is one body left next to the river of Furat. That body, whenever we lift one part of him, another part falls down. Then he told them, come with me. He brought a mat. He said, put all the body parts on this mat. And then he buried his uncle, Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. And he said, there it is said, when he took off the right hand of Abu al-Fadl, he kissed his right hand. And he said, Am Abu al-Fadl. Oh, my uncle, Ya Abbas, I wish you were with us to see my aunt Zainab and the difficulties we've been experiencing after you, Ya Abu al-Fadl. And then he buried his uncle Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas alayhi salam. He buried all those body parts. He buried all those mu'mineen, all the imam and his family members. And then it is said he went back. I say, oh Mawlati, ya Fatima, what is your state like? Because on the day that Fatima alayha salam left this world, she called Amir al-Mu'mineen and she said, Ya Ali, I want to give you my will. He said, yes, Fatima, speak. What do you want to say? She said, Ya Ali, this is the last day for me in this dunya. And I'll be joining my father, Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, shortly. Ya Ali, bury me in the middle of the night when the people have gone to sleep, because I don't want my enemies to come and see my burial or to even recognize where my grave is. And then she told him, Ya Ali, and after me, take care of Hassan and Hussein. فَإِنَّهُمَا مِنْ بَعْدِ يَتِيمَيْنِ بِالْأَمْسِ فَقَدَا جَدَّهُمَا وَالْيَوْمِ يَفْقُدَانِ أُمَّهُمَا. Oh Ali, few days ago they lost their grandfather Rasulullah, and today they'll be losing their mother. Never yell at them, for after me they'll be orphans, and they have no one to turn to. I say, Ya Mawlati, Ya Zahra, I wish you were there to see Imam al-Hussein on the day of Ashura. Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam says, when I wanted to wrap the kafan of Fatima, I called my children. I said, Ya Hassan, Ya Hussein, Ya Zainab, wa Ya Umm Kulthum, ta'alu wa tawada'u ma'a ummikum, fa'innahu al-wida'u al-akhir wal-maw'idu al-jannah. Oh Hassan, Hussein, come and bid the last farewell with your mother Fatima, for this is the last time you see her in dunya until you are all reunited again together in Jannah. Amir al-Mu'mineen says, I saw Imam al-Hassan throwing himself on the body of his mother, calling her Ummah, Ana waladuki al-Hassan ajibini. I am your son Hassan, respond to me. And then I saw Hussein throwing himself on the body of his mother, calling her Ummah, O mother, Ana waladuki al-Hussein, ajibini. I am your mother, I am your son Hussein, respond to me. Amir al-Mu'mineen says, I bear witness, I saw Fatima at that moment crying for Hassan and Hussein. Then she lifted her hands and she embraced Hassan and Hussein, until I hear the cry from the sky telling me, Ya Ali, irfa'huma, falakad abkaya kulla malaikat as-sama. Oh Ali, lift them off the body of their mother, for all the angels in the skies are crying for these orphans of Fatima. I say, oh Fatima, you cried for your son Hussein, you couldn't stand for his response. Even when you were dead, you could not stand crying for him. What about on the day of Ashura, when he was all alone in Karbala and he had nobody for him to take care of him but Shimr and Umar ibn Sa'd, who came and hit Imam Abi Abdullah al-Hussein? Oh Fatima, what was your state when you saw your son for 3 days lying on the plains of Karbala? What was your state when you saw the head of your son on the spears of Bani Umayyah? فاطم لو خلت الحسين مجددا. وقد مات عطشانا بشط فراتي إذا للطمت الخد فاطم عنده وأجريت دمع العين في الوجنات. إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين. This is the conclusion of this majlis. Brothers and sisters, raise your hand for the dua. With these eyes that are full of tears, these eyes that have been crying for Abi Abdullah al-Hussein for 10 nights or 13 nights, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept your dua at this moment. With these eyes full of tears, raise them and all together, let us call, Ya Allah, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Amma yujibu al-mudtarra idha da'a ويكشف السوء أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعا 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 ويكشف السوء. اللهم إنا نسألك وندعوك باسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم 10 times يا الله 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 إلهي بفاطمة وأبيها وبعليا وبنيها والسر المستودع فيها اكشف عنا السوء يا الله. اللهم اغفر ذنوبنا يا الله كفر عنا سيئاتنا يا الله وتوفنا مع الأبرار يا الله مع محمد وآله الأطهار يا الله. ربنا وآتنا ما وعدتنا على رسلك ولا تخزنا يوم القيامة إنك لا تخلف الميعاد. اللهم بالحسين الشهيد اجعلنا من شيعة الحسين يا الله. إلهي بالحسين الشهيد اجعلنا من خدام الحسين يا الله. Oh Allah, we ask you by Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, make us among the sincere servants of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, Ya Allah. Allahumma arzuqna ziyarat al-Hussein fi Karbala, Ya Allah. Ilahi bihaq al-Hussein, arzuqna shafa'at al-Hussein, Ya Allah. اللهم تقبل منا هذا القليل بحق الحسين بأحسن قبولك يا الله. Oh Allah, accept these humble efforts from us by Abi Abdullah al-Hussein يا الله. Oh Allah, fulfill our hajat and needs by the blessing of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein يا الله. Oh Allah, all those mu'mineen who are ill, by the barakah and the blessing of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, grant them quick recoveries, Ya Allah. Allahumma wa kulla man awsawna bid-du'a, all those mu'mineen who have asked us and requested our du'a, Ya Allah, bless their lives in dunya and in the akhirah and fulfill their needs and hajat and grant them quick recoveries, Ya Allah. اللهم اغفر لي ولوالدي وارحمهما كما ربياني صغيرا اجزهما بالإحسان إحسانا وبالسيئات غفرانا. رب اجعلني مقيم الصلاة ومن ذريتي ربنا وتقبل دعاء. اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين آمن المؤمنين في أوطانهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم او الله bless all the مؤمنين and the مؤمنات who remember أبي عبد الله الحسين with peace and security يا الله O Allah, hasten the reappearance of our 12th Imam, عجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف. اللهم اجعلنا من شيعته وأنصاره وأعوانه والمستشهدين بين يديه. اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن. صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه. في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا ودليلا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم أرنا الطلعة الرشيدة والغرة الحميدة واكحل أنظارنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا معه او الله make us with our imam when he calls for the revenge of his grandfather Abi Abdullah al-Hussein when he comes to visit the grave of his mother Fatima and he says this is the grave of my mother Fatima ya Allah اللهم نقسم عليك بالزهراء فاطمة بحسين الزهراء إلا ما قضيت حوائجنا جميعا يا الله وإلا ما رزقتنا شفاعة الزهراء يا الله يا الله يا الله لقضاء الحوائج ولشفاء المرضى ولكشف هذه الغمة عن هذه الأمة ولتعجيل فرج مولانا صاحب العصر والزمان وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات لا سيما أرواح أموات الجالسين والحاضرين رحم الله من يقرأ السورة المباركة الفاتحة مع الصلوات المؤمنين